To the Pelican Rapids High School Band 2024 Winter Concert. These are the seventh graders, lots of energy, and man, have they been doing great. What's been working along with us has been eighth rests and syncopated rhythms, basically. So we've been working on a lot of that stuff, so a lot of the music that you'll hear will have eighth rests and syncopated rhythm. Notably this next one. This next one is one of those Russian dances where they put their bottles on their heads and they do this and then they do this and it gets faster and faster and faster. We're not going to be doing the dance or anything, but we are going to be doing the music. And what happens is, in addition to the eighth rest and syncopated rhythms, they have to speed up exactly together a couple times throughout the piece. So this is the bottle dance, one of many, from Russia, Kalinka by Ivan Larionov. This piece is a 2018 piece by Rob Grice. He uses something called the Lydian mode in this, and really what that means is simply we have the notes of the major scale and we have the first note of the scale, which is kind of our home base, or what we call the tonic. And what they do is they take those same notes, but use a different note as the tonic, and that leads to totally new and interesting and fresh sounding chord progressions and all sorts of stuff. Film composers love the Lydian mode, so you'll probably hear some aspects of film music that you may know in this next piece, although it's not film music itself. This is a claim by Rob Grace. Teaching the syncopated rhythms and using music that uses that, there's many modern pieces that do a really good job of teaching that. But what we did this time is we went way back. We went back to 1868 is when Scott Joplin was born, and he basically is one of the founders of what we call ragtime music. And he was born in, I think it's Arkham, I forget the city. It's down by, it's on the border of Texas, Louisiana, and Arkansas. Arca something. But anyway, he ended up touring around. He was born the son of two slaves, actually, and became a musician and toured around the South, and then came up to Chicago for the World's Fair, during which he met a bunch of other composers that were working on this new music where they kind of played, you know, downbeats with their left hand on the piano, and then the right hand would be playing in between the downbeats. And whenever we do that, we basically create what's called syncopation, and you'll hear that a lot in this next piece by Scott Joplin. This is three of his rags. Syncopated music basically, you know, it became known as ragged time music, and that's how they kind of named it ragtime. And ragtime is basically the precursor to jazz. So it basically ran from, I think, 1890 to 1910, and then after that, the evolution of jazz came about. But this features The Entertainer and some others that you may know. This is a Scott Joplin tribute. All right, well, that was a somewhat complex arrangement of themes from 14 famous orchestral pieces, which are called symphonies. Symphonies are usually large-scale, four-movement pieces that most major composers use to display their very best musical ideas and creativity. Composing a symphony is a challenge, and most composers wrote less than 10 in their lifetimes. In fact, there's a superstition that goes back to Beethoven and Schubert, and continues to today, actually, and it's called the Curse of the Ninth. It was thought that composers were destined to compose only 9 symphonies, and they would die before finishing their 10th, like Beethoven, Schubert, and many others. Well, great symphonist Gustav Mahler, also a great conductor who liked to talk to audiences about this and all this, he kind of laughed at the superstition and bravely went ahead to compose his 10th symphony. Well, guess what happened? He died before completing it. So, The Curse of the Ninth, research that, it's somewhat interesting. So, on a happier note, though, our next tune is a French song in 6/8 time called Vive la Compagnie, which translates to Long Live the Company, meaning people, and is a celebration of life. This is Long Live the Company by Bill Simon. Hit musical Cats, and you'll probably recognize it. It's called A Memory. Cats is literally just a bunch of people dressed as cats, and they sing about life, death, and everything in between. It's actually a very cool thing to watch, but this piece right here is one of the oldest cats who's looking back on her life. Her name is Grisabella, and she's old, and she's sort of disheveled, somewhat sad, and just kind of looking back on her life, thinking about all the great things. So this is Memory. Thank you. So Henry Fillmore composed under 8 different names, and this one he actually used his own. It's his Lasses Trombone. It's actually his most famous piece. You'll hear, he wrote this in 1915, which is, as we know, 5 years after the end of sort of what we call the ragtime era. But he's going to take the march, just like John Philip Sousa did, and basically incorporate some ragtime elements into his marches. And you'll hear that today. This is going to feature our trombones. This is called Lasses Trombone by Henry Fillmore.
Thank you.
All right, this next piece has a great story, so I'm just going to read to you what Robert W. Smith wrote. This is called the Iliad in the 10th year of the Trojan War. It says, the Iliad in the 10th year of the Trojan War is the first movement from the symphony, from the Odyssey, which is Symphony No. 2 by Robert W. Smith. Based upon Homer's literary epic of the same name, the Odyssey brings to the listener an incredible series of adventures and torments as seen through the eyes of Odysseus, king of Ithaca. As the epic begins, Odysseus is called to battle and must sail with his army to take part in the campaign against the city of Troy. After 10 years of bloody warfare and countless unsuccessful attempts to breach the mighty walls of the city, Odysseus suggests a new strategy. Giving the Trojans the impression that the Greeks had withdrawn, their gift of a great wooden horse is wheeled into the city. The Trojans celebrate the long-awaited victory. Odysseus and his most accomplished warriors hide inside the Trojan horse during the revelry, only to surprise the unsuspecting Trojans during their post-celebratory sleep. The final victory belongs to the Greeks as they burn the city of Troy. Beginning with the call of the ram's horn, the musical adventure unfolds. If one listens carefully, the wheels of the Trojan horse can be heard as the horse is pushed into the city. The fires of battle are unleashed as the Greeks bring the 10 years of the Trojan War to an exhaustive conclusion. This is the Iliad in the 10th year of the Trojan War from the Odyssey by Robert W. Smith. Notably, too, Odysseus is a little spacecraft that we just launched into space and landed on the moon just about 2 hours ago. The first time that we've had a craft land on the moon since 1972, over half a century. So pretty cool. That's Odysseus, too. So kind of ironic how that worked out. Anyway, this is the Iliad. That's a great piece, isn't it? Her next piece is called Hymn of Axiom, and it's written and sung by a gal named Vienna Teng, who sings into what we call a vocoder. So she'll sing into the microphone is hooked into this keyboard, and all these cool harmonies can be played with your voice just by playing the keyboard. So I urge you to check it out. This is a great version, but her version is even better. The Hymn of Axiom by Vienna Teng.
Thank you.
playing our last piece already. This is How to Train Your Dragon. You're going to love it. It's very, very good. Thank you for being an awesome audience tonight. And look forward to seeing you. There's a choir concert next week. And elementary band concert coming up in April. Lots of good stuff. And, of course, we'll be back in May to do our final concert with our seniors. So thanks again. And this is How to Train Your Dragon.